Thank you and good morning. Before Dame Julia Polak was appointed Dame Commander of the British Empire by Queen Elizabeth II in 2003, she was Dr. Julia Polak, a young physician who moved with her family to London from her home in Argentina in 1968. She had obtained her medical degrees and early training in histopathology, the microscopic study of diseased tissue, at the University of Buenos Aires. In England, she planned to pursue additional postgraduate studies in histopathology and, after several years, returned to Argentina. A permanent move back to Argentina never occurred, though, as her remarkable scientific career took off. As a member of the Department of Histochemistry at the Hammersmith Hospital, Dame Polak developed immunocytochemical techniques to identify and localize the production of peptide hormones at the cellular level. By the early 1990s, she had been promoted to professor and chair of the Hammersmith Hospital Department of Histochemistry and refocused her research on nitric oxide regulation of normal and disease states, particularly this molecule's role in bone and lung tissue. In a bizarre life twist, Dame Polak was diagnosed with pulmonary hypertension, one of the diseases she was studying, requiring her to undergo a life-saving heart and lung transplant in 1995. This experience on the care-receiving side of the doctor-patient relationship spurred her into a new field, the field of tissue regeneration and engineering. The lack of appropriate donor organs for patient transplant led her to investigate new solutions that utilize our own cells to generate needed tissues and organs, work that she continues to this day. Since 1997, she has served as professor and director of the Tissue Engineering and Regenerative Medicine Center at Imperial College London, overseeing a diverse group of researchers in areas such as biomaterial science and stem cell research. This work has generated a number of patents and resulted in the establishment of the biotech company Novathera to develop and commercialize the center's discoveries. The extent of Dame Polak's research accomplishments is evidenced by her approximately 1,000 published papers, positioning her as one of the most published and also cited scientists of the last two decades. Also by her appointment to numerous editorial boards, and by the international recognition and awards she has garnered from her professional colleagues in pathology and endocrinology, culminating in her receipt of that title, Dame Commander of the British Empire. Please join me in welcoming Professor Dame Julia Polak, who will speak to us this morning on her work with stem cells and regenerative medicine.
Thank you, and thank you, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you for the invitation to see these wonderful autumn colors of your country. It's really very, very nice, but I really didn't expect to talk to a few 5,000 people. I thought I was coming to give a lecture of 50 or 70 people. But the most surprising event was prior to my lecture, a jazz band. It never happened to me. So I'd like to tell you a bit about what we do at Imperial College and the work on tissue engineering and regenerative medicine. I think I'm doing the right thing. So Imperial College is located in quite a trendy area of London. So if you are coming to visit London, try to avoid it because it's horribly expensive. But Imperial College is in an area where Prince Albert, the Prince Consort of Queen Victoria, wanted to develop science and arts on that area, and they developed, they showed a tower, a queen tower, that you can see depicted here. And this has a preservation order, so it cannot be built. So Imperial College was built all around the tower. And it's located in a nice area where the Albert Hall is, and in summer there are the summer concerts, which the area of the ground floor is the promenade concert. It removed the seats, and all the young people are standing there cheering, listening to the most wonderful classical music. And there are a number of associated hospitals that are part of Imperial College. So what is regenerative medicine? Well, it's really, they have many terms like tissue engineering, biomedical engineering, bioengineering, and it's the application of the principles and methods of life sciences, medicine and engineering toward the development of biological substitutes to restore, maintain, and improve body functions. So what is not regenerative medicine? I wish it would be, but it's not. This is me. And it's not either, as my children already are preparing for inheritance money. And it's not what the papers wanted us to believe, that it's in the air on the back of a mouse. So, really, what it is about living a long, healthy life for everybody if we can repair damaged tissue. And in fact, is divided into several segments, which I will go through in the lecture. But if we are able to create a tissue in a test tube with the aid of especially designed materials and cells, we can have tissue engineering. We can also use cells differentiated into a particular lineage to cure a particular diseased organ by the name of cell therapy, or we can stimulate the regeneration of our own body. So helping the body to heal itself. So we can replace by tissue engineering, if we are able to create an organ in a test tube using cells and materials, as illustrated here, or we can have cells prepared in a test tube that will be able to regenerate a particular organ of the body. Or we can stimulate cells which are in our body, stem cells in our body, that will tend to go to the sites of injury. And we can then, if we learn what are the chemicals that these cells contain that allows regeneration, maybe one day we will have a regenerative pill. We'll tell the patient, take this and your lungs will regenerate. I don't think it'll be my lifetime, but it may happen. But it is possible to regenerate because other mammals and other species can regenerate. And what's happening? Have we lost the genes that these animals have? For instance, a deer can regenerate easily when it breaks, or other animals, or we have containing in our body genes that they are suppressing our ability to regenerate. But in order to succeed, regenerative medicine has to combine. We need to come out of our boxes and collaborate between cell biologists, material scientists, geneticists, and all others, because we need to learn how from one cell we become one individual. So, it's needed because we need to create good health and wealth. And by doing so, perhaps one day we could have aging, the natural aging, but not on an unpleasant way, like osteoporosis or Alzheimer's disease or unable to hear or to see. Nobody is extending life, but to make it very pleasant and painless. Or trauma. We can really help to regenerate, and of course we lost the champion of regeneration with continues with the Irving Research Center. So there are a myriad, every disease you can think of could help by this field in the future. Just a few examples: a smoker's lung, or a heart attack, or damaged liver, or many others. And we need that because in many terminal diseases, organ transplantation is the only solution, and there are no sufficient number of organs. Every 18 minutes there is the need for an organ, and most of the patients that need an organ will die before they get a chance. And we need to create cost-cutting in the healthcare and commercialize, and we will have wealth and health in the country. So we move to different stages of regenerative medicine. We need to learn which is the best cell source, how we encouraged the differentiation to a different lineage, to a different tissue type, how we get sufficient number of cells, how we combine with materials, how can we expand these cells that we have them in a petri dish, how we know that these cells perform the function that we are hoping they will perform, how we develop appropriate animal models to test, and how we move to clinical trials. So, although this looks very simple, that can be done by tomorrow, we face mega challenges in every single aspect of regenerative medicine. We need to do more and more research. But we are getting there, as I'll show you later on. So what are the challenges we have on the cell type, which will be the most appropriate? So first we need to decide which cell we want to use. So if we want to use a stem cell is a cell that divides and produces another stem cell, so we have the ability to have stem cells in our body to regenerate, and the sister cell will be of the type of tissue. For instance, if we cut our skin, we can heal, obviously we can regenerate, a baby will leave no scars, the older we get we have more protracted regeneration, but it is due to the fact that we have stem cells in our skin. And the cell needs to remain as a stem cell and divide to make a skin cell. So the older we get, we lose more and more of the stem cells, so the ability to regenerate when we age is more protracted. So we can have, within the stem cells, the famous or infamous embryonic stem cells, and we can have other cells which are a little bit mature within the development, like there are plenty of cells in the bone marrow, stem cells, umbilical cord of is a good source of stem cells. There are niche specific, like I explained to you, in the skin and every organ. Fat has a number of cells. Do we know which best? No. Nobody has done a systematic study comparing in a single identical circumstances different cell types. It's a mega study, should be done, but it hasn't been done as yet. In terms of human embryonic stem cells, these cells come from the very early embryo on the program of in vitro fertilization. And in the UK, once it's a successful fertilization, the eggs are stored, but they cannot be stored for more than 8 years. After 8 years, when they are frozen and it was implanted and the family has the family, two or three children or whatever they want, they are asked whether these, the rest can be destroyed, they cannot be kept forever, or they can be used for research. And if the patient doesn't want to allow research, they are destroyed. So one way or the other, these very early embryos are destroyed. The human, in the UK, we can use imported cells. We can derive embryonic stem cells under license and under ethical approval. We can use therapeutic cloning under license, and reproductive cloning is illegal, is a criminal offense. So where are the cells? Any cell from the development can be used. Here is depicted a fallopian tube, and on day 4 there are already a collection of cells, and at day 5, between 4 and 5, a little cell is taken for the prenatal genetic diagnosis routinely, and you must have read in this country the work of Robert Lanza that is able to derive embryonic stem cells from there. Normally, they are obtained a little later on of the pre-implantation. These are, they cannot be implanted from the inner cell mass on day 6. And then continues. So you have a fertilized egg, then a totipotent stem cell will produce even placenta. These are to use for in vitro fertilization, but not for human cloning. It cannot be done. It's forbidden. Then when it's a hollow ball of cells, the blastocyst, cells can be obtained, and it's embryonic stem cells. When they continue the development, they become a little bit more differentiated and like the cells in the bone marrow, and then totally differentiated like a neural cell. So the examples are illustrated there. So from the bone marrow, plenty of stem cells, they are not embryonic, are obtained, and transplantation is routine clinical procedure for blood disorders. So this may be the best cell for clinical applications in the early days. Then when we learn more about embryonic stem cells, that could be done later on. Umbilical cord contain a burst of embryonic of stem cells, and this can also be used for regenerative medicine. Fat tissue, which is not unethical to take, and at least in the UK. And cells are located in each organ, as I explained to you, about the skin. So, again, we don't know. The stem cells, the adult stem cells from the bone marrow or other tissue, they is useful because transplantation is in routine clinical practice, is from the same person, so are autologous, they will not produce tumors, and there are clinical trials. But they have a more limited development. They are in low numbers, and the older you get, even less. And compared with embryonic, these cells can produce all cell types, they can self-renew, they are easily, can easily be available and grow very rapidly. But if you implant these undifferentiated cells, you can produce a malignant tumor, so they have to be differentiated, it's dangerous. There are huge clinical hurdles. There are ethical problems that the world yet has not settled on, and because they are not from the same patient, can produce a rejection, an immune rejection. The niche specific can be from the same person. They will not produce tumors, have a limited development. They are sometimes difficult to access. To access a stem cell from the brain, to operate the patient, take a bit of the brain and then put it back, may be quite difficult. And they are present in low number. Once we have the cells, we need to learn how we differentiate the cells for the tissue we are interested in. And there are, normally, the embryonic stem cells will tend to differentiate spontaneously into different types. But to coach them to a particular lineage, one needs to do experiments. And it could be by giving growth factors to the soup where you are having your cells in the dish, and other ways which I'll go through. So using that, at Imperial College we were able to obtain pieces of bone, both from mouse embryonic stem cells and from human embryonic stem cells, and we were able to characterize the little pieces of bone, and we were able to obtain peripheral lung cells. There are two types of peripheral lung cells. One that is called type 2, that one can use a marker to distinguish, and these cells can give rise to the type 1 cells, which are flat and they're in contact with the blood vessels, and they produce gas exchange. And these pluripotent embryonic stem cells can give rise to these cells, which ultimately will be functioning type 1 cells able to gas exchange because we have the marker. There are other tricks that one can do. This is an illustration. We can permeabilize the membrane and then we culture with, for instance, lung extracts if we're interested in lung or any other extract. Then we reseal the membrane and we can obtain differentiated cells. And doing so, we are able to obtain a shorter time differentiation because these procedures are cumbersome and take a long time, and it does not produce a pure large amount of desired cell types. But we are getting slowly there by having 17 days instead of 33, a little larger yield like we were having before. So, can we introduce a collection of precursor cells, young cells but not pluripotent, and allow the microenvironment to do the job that we want in the body? So, there is an interesting aspect. We co-culture, we put it in a dish, in a petri dish, pluripotent embryonic stem cells with pieces of lung, and the cells became lung. By contrast, if we put it with cartilage, the cells became cartilage. So the microenvironment obviously is playing an important role. Here is a diagrammatic illustration how we can enwrap the cells with the tissue we are interested, for instance, in this case was lung, and then we see whether the cells differentiate. And this could be very relevant for cell therapy. Maybe we don't need to struggle to produce a whole organ to repair somebody's damaged tissue. Maybe if we have the cells towards a differentiation pathway, then allow the microenvironment to do the job for us. But we still have a mixture of cells when we are in a petri dish. So how can we have pure cells? How we can have a collection of cells? And we can use markers. If the markers are on the surface of the cells, if it's a protein on the surface of the cell, we can label it with a color, and with a machine, we can pull them out and have a collection. So we have to have a specific surface marker, and it's non-invasive, it's real-time, and it's called fluorescent activated cell sorting to purify the cells prior to implantation. We need also materials. So cell biologists alone can provide certain degree of contribution, but not the entirety. And why we need materials? We need them for carriers if we are going to do cell therapy or providing tissue engineering per se, an organ in a test tube. So these materials are combined with the cells. This is a three-dimensional scaffold with the cells, and eventually can be implanted into a living organism. And we have enormous amount of materials, and of course, Dr. Jennifer West is a world expert on that, so I'm only a cell biologist, but there is a great quantity of very suitable materials. This is one bioglass created by your fellow countryman, Professor Larry Hench, and creates an interfacial bone between implant and host tissue. And it was important to know what were the molecular events that took place in the cells. The cells need to attach to the material. Sometimes they repel, so it had to be man-made material, but they need to attach. They need to grow nicely and demonstrate that with the material they grow better, like demonstrated here. They need to differentiate to the lineage you are interested in. In this case was bone lineage, and it can be done three-dimensionally to have a little three-dimensional organ in a petri dish. So three-dimensional configuration to regenerate the tissue material should stimulate cell growth and differentiation, attachment, the position of extracellular matrix, act as a template for tissue growth, for implantation, be resorbable, one doesn't want it all the time, for pharma, be insoluble because we can test drugs in a petri dish. And here we can test for pharma, bioterrorism, household chemicals, a variety if we have a three-dimensional composite of cells and materials in a petri dish. But we still are struggling with the number of cells, even if we purify, even if we put them with the material. We need to bulk up the number of cells in a three-dimensional configuration. So we need to use machines that will permit fluids to come in, because if you grow the cells without nutrients, the middle will die. So we need to rotate them, we need to introduce fluid, we need to monitor what is happening. So this is another aspect of the research. So one illustration is to be ready for preclinical applications. So here is an illustration that these pluripotent embryonic stem cells, if they are conditioned in a special way, but grown for a short period of time with a particular medium, they will produce lots of bone. If the cells are cultured for a bit longer with the same mesoderm medium, they will produce heart. We can have customized lineages, which will be very useful for cell therapy. But ideally, we want to have a closed system that is fully automated, where we put, encapsulate the cells and we put them in there. And we will have control reproducibility, automation, validation, and safety. And it won't have the handling, the human error. It will be fully automated machine and will have a non-invasive sensor that will tell us the amount of sugar we have there, the amount of metabolites, the amount of oxygen, whether we need to put more or less. And they will be very useful for three-dimensional constructs and to use for clinical application. I seem to talk like this and it comes, but didn't. Never mind. An illustration is putting pluripotent stem cells encapsulated in a bead, in a little bead, and then you can differentiate it into bone. You put it in this rotating bioreactor, and you get lots of bone nodules. And ideally, you want to have a closed system that you can give to the clinic, and they can treat a heart patient or a bone fracture or whatever is the clinical need. So, another illustration, cells maintain their pluripotency when they are encapsulated and the alginate beads are biocompatible, FDA approved, can be soluble and injectable. And they maintain their pluripotency for at least 116 days. And here it shows how the cells are alive because we are giving nutrients, so the cells are alive and they stay undifferentiated. Then you take them out of the bead. Oh dear. Of the bead, and they are still undifferentiated. Then you can put differentiated factors to have large collection of cells. So how do we move from all this experimental work to preclinical phase, the animal models, where there is a good variety of very reliable models? We put embryonic stem cells into animals which didn't have an immune system, and we were able to produce bone, pieces of bone, and others are doing different animal models. So we need purification to homogeneity. We need to characterize the cells. We need to see that genetically they are normal and they are good for clinical applications. And the animal models will provide us to analyze the cell fate and engraftment and how they are functioning in vivo before we go to clinical applications. An illustration is an animal model for regenerative medicine for cardiac disease. The heart was injured by ligation of the coronary artery, and the stem cells, allegedly, because it's very controversial, were able to repair the heart muscle. So currently at Imperial, we're trying to repair lungs, and we characterize the cells as peripheral lung cells by various means, including protein expression and gene expression. And then we see that the cells become flattened and they're in contact with blood vessels because they are exchanging gas. And on this, we published a series of papers. And now, currently, we are putting them on animal models of major septicemia or smoking lungs to see whether the cells will repair. Currently, we mark the cells with a substance that we can visualize. We see they go to the lung, and now we need to find out whether they perform a function in the lung before moving to appropriate clinical trials. There are clinical trials, early clinical trials, where a proof of concept that putting bone marrow stem cells can correct children brittle bone disease, or they can correct heart failure, or they had engineered skins as early clinical trials. but the criteria should be robust. We need to use large numbers, double-blind, randomized, we don't need to know to avoid bias, and it needs to be confirmed by many other workers. But the field is moving. When I am asked, when do you think we will have an organ in a dish, I used to say, well, it will take another 5 or 6 years. But now, you see, recently, Tony Atala produced functioning bladders for children and lasted for 8 years. So we are moving faster than I would have thought. So the field of stem cells, tissue engineering, gene therapy, nanotechnology are all converging to produce clinical applications to cure human beings. So a revolutionary medical discipline with enormous implications for therapy and economic impact. I think the future is here, but I don't see it, but I hope it will be seen soon. So Imperial College is very multidisciplinary with enormous amount of departments doing different aspects of regenerative medicine. My own little team contributes with cell biology. Thank you.